George Mariner Mall here for the Discovery Orchestra. In this Discovery Orchestra chat, we will proceed further into the third movement of Dvorak's Symphony No. 9. The overall recipe, or form, for this movement is ternary. That is, there are three big parts. But each of these three large parts has two contrasting sections. We will now investigate the B section of that first large part. But before we do, do you remember how the A section ended? It was really bombastic. Have a listen. The B section, by way of contrast, is very gentle. Listen to just a little bit of it. Composers just don't like to abruptly jump from one section to another. Listen to what it would sound like if Dvorak had done that. Kind of jolting, don't you think? So they write transitions. Listen to the transition Dvorak writes at number 6 in the listening guide. As it says, the music quiets down. We have a decrescendo, a gradually getting quieter. And did you notice the nice little conversation between the strings and the bassoon at the end? Listen once more. Now listen from the end of section A through the transition to section B, and notice how logically and smoothly Dvorak's musical thoughts proceed. Let's examine the theme of the B section. There is a timbre question to answer here in the listening guide. Which other woodwind instrument is playing with the oboe at number 7? The oboe is so dominant, it might be difficult to ferret out the other sound. Listen once more. It's the flute. It's then passed to the two clarinets in the orchestra playing in unison, 8 notes apart, just as the flute and oboe had done. Listen to the clarinets play this, and see if you can also detect Dvorak's very sparing use of the triangle as well. At number 8, the flute and oboe come back, playing a slightly different melody in the same style and flavor, and then hand off to the blank and the bassoon, who played the B section theme as we encountered it before. See if you can figure out who plays with the bassoon. Here's a hint. It's one of the strings. And as you can see in the guide, we have a hint. We'll start with the flute and oboe. Yes, that's the cello section, all 10 of them playing with the bassoon. Perhaps you noticed that the stringed instrument in the guide has an end pin on it, which is, of course, what all cellos need to stick into the floor for support while they play. One last little point about section B. You will notice in the guide at number 7 that it says Trio 1 under section B. Without getting into too much discussion, trios are generally played by just 3 instruments. And eventually, larger compositions like symphonies also had sections called trios in one of the movements, again, originally played by just 3 instruments. But that practice began to be abandoned in symphonies, with composers choosing instead to have the entire orchestra play the trios. However, they kept calling these sections trios for old time's sake or for tradition's sake, I guess, but it can be confusing. All right, we're now going to move to the middle section of our ternary recipe, the next really big chunk, which, as you can see on the screen at the top of your listening guide, is A in quotation marks, followed by C. This means that Dvorak is going to bring back his wild Native American dance A section. But again, he can't just jump from this gentle B section back to A, so he creates another clever transition. Your mission is to figure out what theme it's based on. We'll start the music at number 9, the beginning of this transition. Sorry to cut the music off so abruptly, but that is the end of this transition, which is based on the Section A theme. And talk about clever. When we had to go from the wild A section to the gentle B section, Dvorak used decrescendo, getting gradually softer. Going in the reverse direction, from the gentle to the wild Native American dance, he used crescendo. Note that also, when the transition begins at number 9, he put the A section theme into a major key. Here it is in minor. Now here it is in major. I put A in quotation marks at number 10 because it's really a condensed, very shortened version of A, compared to its length at the beginning of the movement. Now, there are 2 questions to answer at number 10. How many times does this occur? And how many times does this occur? Here's the entire number 10. Enjoy its explosive character and fill in the blanks. Here's just the tail end of number 10. Okay, so that would be 4 of the shorter version and 2 of the longer version. We've just finished a very truncated version of Section A. It's now time to go to the part of this big middle section of our ternary recipe, Section C, also called Trio 2. It's also gentle, like Section B was. So we're going to need another, yes, transition. And this one gives you the opportunity to recognize a recycled theme from a previous movement. Let's have a quick review of the themes from the first and second movement. Thank you. So now that we've reviewed the themes from movements 1 and 2, you're ready to play that new internet game, What's My Recycled Theme? Here's the music at number 11. And the answer is, no drum roll please, Theme 1 from Movement 1, played first by the cellos and then by the violas. Let's listen to the orchestra again at number 11. Okay, let's listen to the Section C theme. It's so much more charming with the orchestra. For those of you who have studied and performed classical music, you know that the double bar line with the two dots indicates that the music should repeat, and so it does. Dvorak gives us a new idea now at number 13 with trills in descending sequence. We remember that a sequence is a repetition that changes pitch, either ascending or descending. And to remind you, a trill is a very rapid alternation between two adjacent pitches. Here's the new idea with its trills and four-step descending sequence. And here's the new idea at number 13, played by the orchestra. Count the descending steps of the sequence and notice that it repeats, played first by the strings and then by the woodwinds. It almost seems like Dvorak is trying to make us feel like we're out in the countryside, either in his native Bohemia or maybe somewhere in Iowa, especially at number 14, where he unmistakably imitates bird calls. Count the number of trill pairs. Here's a sample one. There's one pair. Now count the number of pairs. It's like birds calling to each other. Hopefully, you found four pairs of trilling birds. Below number 14, the guide says that number 12 through 14 repeats with one change. Number 12 itself does not blank. And at number 15, it says there is one last play of the music at number blank. We're going to play all of this music for you. See if you can answer both of these questions, which can be only answered, of course, if you really listen. Here we go at number 12 for the first time. Thank you. So, what did you uncover? Hopefully, that number 12 itself does not repeat when we go back to number 12, and at number 15, the music of number 12 gets played again for the last time. We also hope you enjoyed Dvorak's delicious, delicate use of the triangle at various times. Since this is a ternary recipe, at some point we've got to get back to the music that sounds exactly like the beginning, and we will. How about we play the music at number 16, which serves as a very short transition? Wherever you are, except in your car, of course, if that's where you are, raise your hand when we get back to the music of the beginning, our wild Native American dance. I knew you could do it. All right. Things proceed just as they did at the beginning, until we get to a special ending, or coda, that Dvorak, like many composers, stuck on the end of a movement. Look at number 27, where we have a pair of questions and answers in a two-step ascending sequence. Listen to this and figure out from which movement and on which theme the question is based, and on what other theme the answer is based. Here's the music. Yes, the question is based on theme one from movement one, and the soft answer is the section A theme from the movement we're exploring right now. The third movement. Listen again. Two more things remain to be solved. At number 28, it says the first part of the question is repeated blank times. Have a listen. It happens three times. And now, another quote from the first movement. Here again are the contestants. Your mission is to decide which theme it is. The first theme? The second theme? Or the closing theme? And who plays it? There's a big visual hint in the guide. Here's the orchestra. And the answer is the closing theme from movement one, played in this case by the two trumpets of the orchestra in unison. Now, before we end this chat, we want you to experience the full impact of the exciting coda. And to remind you, at this point, that you're listening to the members of the Baltimore Symphony Orchestra under Marin Alsop, courtesy of Naxos of America, Incorporated. Here now is from number 25 in the listening guide, To the End. Thank you.